starting in the 65th chapter, verses 17 to 25, which you can find on page 696 in your pew Bibles. For I am about to create a new heavens and a new earth. The former thing shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth. One who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, nor bear children of calamity, but they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food, shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy all my holy mountains, says the Lord. The psalm this morning is Psalm 118, first two verses, and then 14 to 24, found on page 565 in the Old Testament. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of John, 20th chapter, verses 1 to 18, found on page 114 in the New Testament. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been rolled from the tomb. So she ran and went to see Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting there where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." She told them that he had said these things to her.
Well, thank you, choir. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Amen. I wonder what it was like to be Mary Magdalene on that first Easter morning. As her name implies, and to differentiate her from all the other Marys, she is called Mary Magdala because she was from Magdala, a city on the northwest shore of the Galilee. It had been one of the largest cities on the lakeside. Now Magdala, where Mary was from, was right next to Cana of Galilee, which we hear about so often in the Gospels. You'll remember Cana was Jesus' Galilean headquarters. So Magdala was just a little piece down the road. I guess you could even say that this Mary was the girl next door. She supported Jesus. She invested in the movement of Jesus Christ and in his ministry. And she also gave that sweat equity of domestic service to Jesus and the disciples. She followed Jesus. And this Mary of Magdala was with him all the way to the cross. Yes, all the way to the cross and beyond to burial. Now, we don't know a whole lot about Mary of Magdala. Three of the Gospels don't really speak to us regarding her character whatsoever. And only the Gospel of Luke says that she had seven demons that had gone out of her. Now, this probably meant that she suffered from the stigma and the ostracization of being an epileptic. In that primitive culture, epilepsy was understood as demon possession. But Jesus had healed her. Jesus delivered her, and she was so grateful. She loved Jesus, and she followed him. Now, later traditions get involved in this, you see. Later traditions get into the act. And in their traditions that come hundreds of years later, they ascribe to Mary of Magdala an immoral life. But it's important to note this. There is absolutely no biblical warrant for that. In fact, it probably served a very dark and oppressive agenda. You see, some of the later church fathers didn't like her female prominence in this gospel story. And sadly, there are some still of this ilk at large in the church today. Even in the 1600s, John Calvin wrote regarding Mary Magdala as he reviewed the gospel John. He was just stupefied to try and understand why Jesus Christ would reveal his resurrected self to a woman. But he rejoiced she had the good sense to go and get two men to come and testify to the validity of the resurrection. Now, friend Calvin, you blew it. You see, the two that came to testify didn't stick around. They went home. Maybe Jesus revealed his resurrected self to Mary because in her devotion and in her faithfulness, my word, She was the only one that was there. Wow. What I want you to remember is that Mary was a passionate Christian. She was a penitent. She was delivered by this Jesus Christ who loved her, whom she followed and served with incredible love and devotion and gratitude. And so we find her early on that third day, while it was still dark, way up before the others, first thing, and she goes to the tomb of our Lord. Oh, how she grieved. Oh, how her heart was broken. Oh, how she missed him. Perhaps being near that tomb, remembering him, still standing by, maybe that would comfort her. But as she draws near to this tomb, she sees the tomb has been disturbed. All is not in order. The tomb is empty. And she turns and runs with reckless abandon. She runs with fury, first to Peter, and then to John with the news about what has happened. "Come and see," she says. "Hurry, hurry, hurry. Where have they taken him?" Peter and John indeed run to the tomb, and they confirm the evidence. The body is not there. Only the shroud and the cloths remain. It may be that the beloved disciple in our text gets it and starts to put together the idea of the resurrection, but the sentence construction is awkward and unclear. It just may be that he gets it, that the body is not there, it has been removed. And so, having confirmed the disappearance of the body, Peter and John return to their homes, leaving Mary alone in tears. A little while passes, and Mary, crying, finally looks into the tomb herself, and she sees there two angels who ask her, Woman, why are you crying? And she explains, "They have taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they have put him." What a powerful response she makes to these angels. Whether alive or dead, Jesus is still, for her, most definitely her Lord, her leader. But the grief is compounded because now she doesn't even have a bona fide grave to visit. Even this small comfort of going to the grave is deprived from her. And at that very moment, at that very bottoming out, empty, soul, torn moment, she sees Jesus. He's standing there. And through her tears, through her stained, tear-flowing eyes, she thinks, maybe he's the gardener. And he too says, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Maybe this man, she thinks, can give her hope of recovering Jesus' body. Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you put him. I'll come get him. Even the prospect of putrefied, disturbed, unwrapped remains of a man beaten, crucified, murdered, do not put her off from her commitment and her commendable devotion. And then, standing before her, Jesus says her name. He says, "Mary." He speaks her name as suddenly she knows. It's him. She knows this in how he calls her name. Her heart has been touched and moved by his calling of her name, by his voice, these words, this intonation before. He calls her name. And in joy, she cries out, Rabboni, which is the most intimate form, the most tender form to say teacher. And so she is the first to witness and experience Jesus Christ resurrected. She is overcome with joy. Jesus tells her two things following. He tells her to restrain herself from holding on to him, for he has not yet ascended to the Father. And then he instructs her to go instead to my brothers and tell them that I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God. I wonder if this is why the early church worked so hard to besmirch Mary of Magdala. You see, not only was she the very first in John's gospel to experience and be encountered by the resurrected Lord when Peter and John left the scene and went home, she is ordered by Jesus, literally sent by Jesus to the disciples with the first message of the resurrected Christ. Do you know what that word in Greek is, that title for one who is sent? It's the word apostle. My goodness. Mary, a woman, was in fact the first to merit the title apostle. So today from her, we learn that Jesus Christ is resurrected. From her, we are told that the living Christ continues on, not to be contained and held onto. He is alive, he lives, and he continues on. And we should not hold on to him as in holding on to the past. From her, we receive Christ's message of his pending ascension and the good news of the resurrection reality. For he goes to his God and our God. He goes to his Father, our Father. And so we know from this message given to Mary by Jesus that because of the resurrection, truly and certainly, Jesus is God the Father, is our Father and our God, and nothing can ever, ever take us away from the reality of our relationship to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. But probably most powerfully of all, we who have indeed heard him call our names, just like he called Mary's, know that our love and our devotion and our commitment is never in vain. And that Jesus comes to those who stand by the grave with love, devotion, and commitment in their hearts. It is victory. For Jesus lives. Yes, indeed, my friends. The Lord is risen. He is risen.